Okay, I think we should start our class, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, I will just share the file. One file. So can you see the whiteboard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
It's
visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we'll be doing three problems. One is design of non-standard flanges, and then the design of the tall vessels and the design of the support of the vessel. So these three topics we will cover in my part, and Professor Ganguly has covered the other parts. So what I will do, I think the Saurabh Sengupta and Devashish Roy are the TA for this particular course, and I think they have already uploaded the soft copy of the textbook, B.C. Bhattacharya's book, and the assignment on the design of non-standard flange is also uploaded. Okay.
Yes.
So in the MS Teams, please go through them. So in this class, what I will do, I'll just give a broad overview of the topic, and give an outline of whatever the calculations procedures those will be involved in the design of the flange calculations. Okay. So once this lecture will be over, you'll get an idea how to do the calculations, and then you can go through the example problems and of the textbook, and you have to contact several tables, etc. I will let you know, and then you have to attempt the assignment problem, finish it off, and then email the solution to one of the email address that has been provided by the TA. Okay, and also confirm by the TAs that whether they have got the assignment correctly or received the assignment. Because in the last semester, in one of the courses, at the end of the course, we have identified that a student sent all the assignments, but to a wrong email address. So we did not receive the any of the assignments. And after final grading, even the grades were announced that time. And in January, he pointed this out. I don't know whether that is correct or not, but that time we had nothing to do. So the grades were, the solution was out, the grading was completed, the semester was over. We could not take the assignments from him, and he got a lower grade. So that was the situation that happened. So this time, please get the confirmation from the TAs, Saurabh and Devashish, that whether they have received the assignment or not. Okay, so that is very, very important, it seems.
Sir, I would like to interrupt here. What we can do is that we can probably, after the deadline, within 1 week of the deadline, we can publish a Excel file or something of that sort, which will list the students who have not submitted, whose assignments we have not received. So if that is maintained, those students can see it.
Yeah.
I think that is a very good idea. Yes.
Sir, one more point. I think all the students can use MailTrack when you are sending the files. Okay, so you will be notified immediately when we will be opening your mails.
Sir, or else TAs can create a assignment portal in MS Teams itself. You can submit it in MS Teams itself. Like there's an option called assignment, and if they create an submission assignment in the Teams, we can submit via that, and then TAs can check it from there.
Yeah, Sanmukh, SST Sanmukh, right?
Yes, Avardhan.
Yeah, So actually, we are aware of that feature, but we are not sure whether all the students will be conveniently able to use that. That's why we don't want to,
we have previously, for other subjects, we have used this portal. So give it a try. Like for first time, we can submit via mail and this assignment. And okay, from okay. next.
Okay, we'll let you know. Right.
We will let you know after discussion with Sara. We will let you know. Okay.
Yeah. That's for you.
Yeah, that's fine. So either way, it means it should be very clear to Saurabh Devashis and also to the students that whether things have been properly transferred or not. Okay. So in this lecture, we'll be looking for the design aspects of non-standard flanges. Kindly mute your microphone. First, we see what is the purpose of flange. Purpose of flange is to provide a leak-proof joint between the two pieces of pipes, vessels, etc. To provide Okay, so there are two types of flanges. I think all these informations are there in your textbook also. So anyway, I'm just, for the sake of, convenience, I'm just telling you, otherwise there will be, gap in that. So one is the first one is the narrow-faced flange. All face contact area lies inside the circle, enclosed by the bolt holes. So that is called the narrow facet flange. All face contact area, that means the contact area between faces of the two flanges, by the bolt holes. Okay, so and what is the white facet flange? Face contact area lies outside the bolt circle So and what is a bolt circle? Bolt circle is the imaginary circle that covers all the bolts. Okay, so that means if you connect all the bolts, the circle that is created, it is called the bolt circle. Okay, so most of the flanges which are narrow facet, so these narrow facet flanges are the most common because the tightening of the gasket between the two surfaces will be better. So there are different types of narrow facet flanges. First one is the plain face. So let's say this is the cross section of the two pieces. Okay, so the bolt will be somewhere here. So this is the bolt. In between, you place the gasket. So Gasket is basically an annular material of made by neoprene rubber or asbestos if there is a very high pressure inside. And this is the just cross section view of the joint. Okay, so here is the bolt. So the bolt circle is up to here. So gasket lies within the bolt circle. Okay, so this is the contact area between the two. Okay, so here lies the gasket. Now, both the features of a plain face, flanges, both connections are identical. Okay, this simple in construction. Good for low pressure. Because if pressure increases, as it lowers, the possibility of gasket blowout. Okay, so gasket plays a very important role. Gasket is being tightened by the gasket is placed between the two pieces, and then the bolts are tightened, and so that the gasket will be placed tightly between the two faces, providing a leak-proof joint. Okay, so if the pressure inside is pretty high, then the gasket may flow outside or blow out, and then there will be a leakage occurs. So flange calculation includes gasket calculation and bolt circle diameter, calculation of the bolt circle diameter, as well as the number of bolts. Also the flange thickness, but we will not be doing the flange thickness. We will be doing up to the number of bolt calculations. Okay, so this is the plain faced flange. Second one is the raised faced will be that the lower surface is slightly raised. So this surface is raised and the gasket is placed here. Then this is the bolt circle. Here you place the bolt. Okay. So what is the advantage of this raised face? It ensures better compression. When you tighten the bolt, it ensures the better compression here. Compression of gasket. Okay. There is no possibility of contact between metal pieces, that means metal faces, okay, after tightening the bolt. Now, in case of plain facet flange, if you tighten the bolt too much, then there is a possibility of contact between the two pieces. But in case of raised face flange, the compression load will be completely taken by the gasket. And even if you tighten the bolts, a bit more, then there is the possibility of the contact between the two faces becomes minimal. And contact of the two faces, whenever there is a contact between the two faces, there is a possibility of leakage, okay? Because there is a minor surface irregularities, and what gasket does under compression, gasket fills up the minor surface irregularities and make a completely leak-proof joint. Then third type of flange is male and female.
Sir?
Yes.
Where will the pipe or vessel be placed?
No. So if this is the thing, then the lower portion, this part is basically the vessel. Okay. This is a vessel. And top part is basically a head. This one is basically a head. Then you are having a matching part on the top, right? So this is head. So this is the head. This is the vessel, top part of the vessel. These two will be tightened by this bolt using this gasket. That means you place a gasket and another gasket between the two, and then tightened by number of bolts. And I have shown the cross section of that, showing only one bolt. Now, is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then this male and female type of flanges, it will be like this. You place the gasket here, and then this is the bolt. So what is the advantage is that one face is raised and the other face is recessed. And the other is depressed. And this is very useful, advantageous for high operating pressure. Because you are basically eliminating the gasket blowout. So even if the high pressure, the gasket expands, but because of this structure, the blowing out of the gasket is prevented. Okay, so it is the male and female. Then fourth one is the tongue and groove. Tongue and groove type. So this will be something like this. And you have a bolt here. So there is a tongue here, and there is a groove here. In between, you place the gasket. So here you completely prevent the gasket blowout possibility. So again, it is used for the high pressure. Used for high pressure operation. Gasket blowout is prevented. Okay, and the last one is ring type. You place a O-ring between the two faces, okay? And put the bolt here. So place the O-ring between the two faces. That means there is a groove between the in the two in the inner surface of the two faces, and you place a O-ring so that there is a groove at the generally there is a groove in the lower face, so that the O-ring is placed there and a little bit portion of the O-ring is outside the groove. Then you put the top flange and tighten by the bolt so that the throughout the whole periphery of the bolt circle diameter, less than inside the bolt circle diameter, the whole place is completely blocked by the rubber O-ring or asbestos O-ring that prevents the leakage. So O-ring is placed in a groove. What is the advantage of use of O-ring? Different dimensions of O-ring are different dimensions means different diameters of the O-ring and the thickness of the O-ring are available in the market. You can directly purchase from the market and utilize it without doing a special construction. So you can directly use them. Okay. Next one is the gasket calculation. So these are the different types of flanges. Next we go for the gasket calculation. For gasket calculation, first thing is how to select a gasket. So what is a gasket and its selection? Gasket and selection. Okay. Now the metal parts between the two faces, the metal parts have minor surface irregularity. You can see with our naked eye because those are in micron range. The heights are in micron range. If you would like to see them, then you probably have to use a microscope. So metal pieces have minor surface irregularities. Therefore, the tightening is difficult, making the if you do not use a gasket, the tightening of the metal pieces becomes difficult and there is a leakage. Thus, to have a leak-proof joint, tightening, the gaskets are used. It's a soft packing material. Soft packing material like asbestos, rubber, aluminium, etc. In most of the cases, asbestos and rubber are used. There is something called yield stress or gasket seating stress, denoted as Y. This is the stress required to flow the gasket or basically to disintegrate the gasket. The stress needed to flow the gasket. Flow the gasket means the gasket is basically broken, so disintegrated. So that is called the gasket seating yield stress or gasket seating stress, and this is basically a property of the material. Property of gasket material. Okay. Then something called gasket factor. M, and it is defined as residual gasket stress divided by internal pressure. So again, M is a property of the gasket material. You need not to note down this lecture, because this lecture, soft copy of this lecture in PDF version will be available to you after the lecture, maybe within a couple of days. So we will upload this lecture in the MS Teams. Okay. Common types of gasket materials with gasket factors and setting stage Y are given in table 7.1 in your textbook. So if you look into table 7.1 in your book, then for common gaskets, the values of M and Y are given. So you can go to the table and can find the values of M and Y for different types of gaskets and can utilize them, okay, in your calculation. Basic gasket width or effective gasket width. Now, due to fine irregularities of the metal surface, the effective gasket width is slightly less than the actual width of the gasket. Okay, so due to fine irregularities of the metal surface, the actual or basic or effective, we should call it effective gasket width, slightly less than the actual physical width of the gasket. So for different flanges, the basic and the effective gasket widths are given in table 7.2. In table 7.2, you can look in table 7.2, there the basic and effective gasket widths are given. Okay, again we can go to that particular table and find out for what type of flange you are talking about, what will be the basic gasket width and the effective gasket width. Temperature and pressure consideration. Now, based on the design temperature and design pressure, the gasket material is selected. Okay, so we should know what is the design temperature and pressure. So based on design temperature and pressure, the gasket material is selected. So that is presented in table 7.3. So you can look into the table 7.3 and can find out and find that there is a list of materials which are suitable for different temperature and pressure range. Okay. Next, we find out what is gasket dimension, how to calculate the gasket dimension. So if we do a force balance, okay, then the residual gasket force is equal to gasket setting stress minus the actual hydrostatic pressure in the vessel, pressure force, gasket settings, not stress, it will be force. we are multiplying by the area. We are multiplying the stress by the area, so therefore it becomes force. So what will be residual gasket force? It will be pi by 4 d naught square minus di square, whereas d naught and di are the outer and inner diameter of the gasket, multiplied by p times m. Okay, p is the actual operating pressure. What is the actual operating pressure? Actual operating pressure is 5% more than the design. It is a design pressure. Actual operating pressure means is basically design pressure. Actual operating pressure or design pressure. How to calculate the design pressure? So this is not the actual operating pressure. Actual operating pressure, design pressure is 5% more of operating pressure. So we are over designing the system for safety. So if the operating pressure is P, that means if I would like to operate the if the pressure inside the vessel is, let's say, 50 bar, then your design pressure will be 5% more of that. So 1.05 times P. Okay, so that is the design pressure multiplied by the M. M is the gasket ratio. And what is the gasket sitting force? It is nothing but pi by 4 d naught square minus di square multiplied by the y. Okay, and what is the hydrostatic pressure? Pi d square by 4 times p. Okay, so from this you will be getting a relationship between the outer diameter and inner diameter. D0 by di is equal to root over y minus pm divided by y minus pm plus 1. The values of y and m you will be getting from the table on the selection of the gasket, and p is nothing but the design pressure. And design pressure is 5% excess of the operating pressure. Thickness and the gas, width of the gaskets are related as there is a heuristic of thickness and width of the gasket. Okay, so it is also there in one of the tables in your book. Thickness in millimeter, then width in millimeter. If it is 3 millimeter thickness, then width can be up to 20 millimeter. If it is 4, then it is 20 to 30. Okay, if it is 5, then it is greater than 30. So roughly there is a guideline for thickness and the width. So once the outer diameter, inner diameter, thickness, etc. are calculated of the gasket, then we can go for the bolt calculations. Okay, so first you know the what is the selection of the bolt spacing between, because where we have to place the at what is the distance between the two neighboring bolts. Okay, that is the bolt spacing. Call this BS. So it is basically distance of the centers of the two adjacent bolt. Okay. So typical thumb rule is, bolt spacing should be lying between 2.5D and 4D. So D is the bolt diameter. And in a bolt, there are two diameters. One is the stem diameter, another is the root diameter. So if you look into the bolt looks something like this. So this diameter is called the stem diameter. And this diameter is the root diameter. And this D will be calculated based on the stem diameter, outer one. What is the, so bolt spacing should not be very large, should not be very less. If it is very less, then it is very difficult to tighten the bolts. If it is very large, then the bolt compression will not be uniform throughout the bolt circle. So typically, it is selected between 2.5D to 4D, where D is the stem diameter of the bolt. Okay. What is bolt diameter? So there are, you know, if you look into one of the tables in your, in this chapter, there are different types of bolts available, like M 10 into 1, M 10 into 2, okay, M 14 into 2. So this simply means M 10 into 1 indicates, this is a nomenclature of any bolt. If you go to the market, you have to tell that I like 10 into 1 bolt, I like 10 into 2 bolt, like that. That means stem diameter is 10 mm. Depth is 1 millimeter. What is depth? Depth is basically this portion, this is known as the depth. Depth of the bolt. Okay. So what is the bolt root area? Root area of one bolt, this is nothing but pi by 4 stem minus 2 depth whole square, and this unit is millimeter square. So this is the root area of a particular bolt. Okay, then we go for the number of bolt calculations and bolt circle diameter. Okay, so let's look into the, you know, particular face of a bolt of the flange. So this will be something like this. Okay, this is the one part. So probably this is the center of the vessel. Okay, so there is a matching part on this side. There's a matching part on this side. So I'm just looking for one cross section. This is the inside of vessel. This is the center line of the vessel. So there is, it's a cylindrical vessel. I'm just looking one part of the cross section. There is a matching part on the other side. Okay. And this is the central axis or of the cylindrical vessel. Okay, there is a gasket placed over here. This flange is placed on the outside of the vessel. So this diameter is B, this dimension is B. Okay. Then there is a bolt here, so we place the bolt. So this is the central line of the bolt. This is known as the radial clearance. This is the small radius of curvature of the slanted portion here, and this thickness is known as the hub thickness. It is the nomenclature is G1. Okay. And the gasket sent the radius from gasket or diameter from gasket center to the center of the vessel, it is denoted as G. Okay. And this is the flange thickness. T is the flange thickness. So this picture shows a half of the shell along the gasket, cross section of. Shell is basically the vessel, cylindrical shell, along the gasket. So what is Boole circle diameter? Boole circle diameter is the distance from the center to the center of the bolt, this distance. So C is Boole circle diameter. This is B plus 2 G1 plus R. Okay, what is B? B is the nothing but outer diameter of shell. How to calculate the outer diameter shell? If you know the inner diameter of the shell, you have already known how to calculate the thickness of the cylindrical vessel. We can calculate the thickness of the cylindrical vessel, multiply by twice. Okay, then ID of the shell plus twice of the thickness, that will give the OD of the shell. G1 is the hub thickness that will be provided when the flange is given. R is radial clearance. G is the distance between the center of the vessel and midpoint of gasket. Yeah. G is the center of vessel and gasket midpoint. This is the distance. Okay. And T is the flange thickness. So this is one relation for the Boole circle diameter. Another relation is from geometrical consideration. What is that? If there are n number of bolts and BS is the bolt spacing, then Boole circle diameter is nothing but the outer periphery, right? Perimeter. So N times BS divided by pi. So this comes from the geometry, where N is the number of, so this is equation number 2, and that is 1. BS is bolt spacing. N is the number of bolts. Okay. So N should be selected when C calculated from equations 1 and 2 is the closest. Not only that, it will be n should be a multiple of 4. I will be coming to that later on. So let us now go to the how to calculate the number of bolts. Number of bolts calculation. First we do that. So for that we have to calculate the bolt load. So what is the bolt load under internal pressure? When W0 is called minimum bolt load, So it has two parts, H and HP. All these are in your textbook. I'm just giving an outline so that the calculation will be simpler. So what is H? H is load due to design pressure. P on an area, pi g square by 4. Okay, so this will be equal to P times pi g square by 4. Next one is HP. HP is load to have adequate compression of gasket under pressure. What is that? This is nothing but pi g multiplied by 2b into mp. Okay. So what is g? G is the diameter of location of gasket load reaction. Okay, that where it will be the gasket load reaction will be taking place, that particular location is known as that particular diameter. And what is, how to calculate this? This is mean diameter of gasket contact face. If B is the B naught is less than 6.3 millimeter, and the value of B naught, how to calculate the B naught, that will be given in one of the tables. Please look into that. And if it is greater than 6.3 millimeter, then it is gasket OD minus 2B. If B naught is greater than 6.3 millimeter. And what is 2B? 2B is the effective gasket pressure width. And what is M? M is the gasket factor. So what is the, then comes WG. WG is the bolt load under bolting up condition. We have tightened the bolt. Under bolting up condition, that is pi into G B times Y. Y is the gasket setting stress. Okay, so from here you will be calculate the, what is the minimum bolting area required. So there are two areas. Okay, A0 is the bolt area needed under operating condition. There is W naught by S naught, where S naught is the allowable stress for bolt material. Okay, at design temperature. What is AG? AG is another area. WG by SG. This is the bolt area under bolting up condition. Bolts are already tightened. So what is SG? SG is the allowable stress. For bold material at atmospheric temperature. So we select M as larger of A naught and AG for a safe design, okay? And then we calculate the number of bolts. Number of bolts will be N equal to AM divided by root area of A bolt. So you get some number here. The actual number of bolts should be a multiple of 4. That means if you get a number of bolts, let's say 19.28, then you should select the number of bolts as 20. If you get a number of bolts from this calculation as 6.56, then you should select 8 as the number of bolts. It should be multiple of 4. How to select a bolt? Selection of bolt is also important, because if you select M 10 into 1, then it will be having a particular root area. If you select 10 into 2, then root area will be different. If the root area is different, then the number of bolts calculation will be different. So you can go to refer table 7.4. And there are, you can go to, you can refer table 7.4, and you can see there are various, bolts are, listed with different radial clearance and other parameters. So for that, if you look into, there is a solved exercise example problem 7.1. If you look into that, they have calculated particular bolt. So you just first guess, let's say I am selecting M 10 into 1, then calculate C from equation 1, then calculate C from equation 2. There is the geometric constant NBS by pi, and check whether this calculation is closer or closest or not. How to check whether it will be closer or it will be differing? You select the next one, M 10 into 2, and check whether the two values are coming close or they are going apart. If they are going apart, then you select another bolt just above 10.1, let's say M 8 into 4. Then you calculate C1 and C2, and probably in this case you can see that C1 and C2 are coming closer. Then you go above of that and check C1 C2 from both that, if the C1 C2 is that. So you have to select the bolt where C1 and C2 are closest. If you look into that particular example, it will be very clear. So once that is done, then you can select that particular bolt. Once the particular bolt is selected, you can find out the particular root area. Once the particular root area is obtained, then you can find out the number of bolts. Then you can select the actual number of bolts, which will be the next number, that is the multiple of 4. Okay, and the flange thickness calculation is not necessary, because there are correlations. From here you can just calculate the flange thickness. Anyway, so your flange calculation involves the gasket selection, gasket calculation involving the ID of the gasket, OD of the gasket, thickness of the gasket, then calculation of the bolt circle diameter, number of bolts, and what will be the type of bolts. So what will be the type of bolts will come first, then the number of bolts. Okay. So this way the this particular assignment has to be done. And if you look into example 7.1 that is solved in your textbook, the whole calculation will be clear to you. And there are some values are also given in the assignment problem. So you can just take the assignment, do the calculation, and submit. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if you just please go through the solved problem of the textbook and go through that this particular chapter of the flange calculation. Okay, before the flange thickness calculation, all the portion will be covered in this particular assignment. Please go through once and also the example problem, the loose type of flange that whatever they have solved in the book. Try to understand and then solve the then go through lecture notes and solve the assignments. If you have any doubt, absolutely no problem. At any point of time you can mail me for any doubt in any if you have any doubt at any point of time of calculation, you can mail directly to me, or you can mail Devashish or Shourav, so we'll clarify your doubt. Okay, so once you finish up the assignment, you just send a soft copy to the mail or upload whatever that Shourav and Devashish will decide how to submit the assignments. I think Shourav once told me that he will be creating a separate email address, and you can send the solution to the email, whatever that you decide. Okay.
Yes, sir. So, the deadline be 1 week, like earlier.
Yeah, I think one week is good enough. In fact, they can solve this problem in a couple of hours, so that should not be a big issue. So, deadline is 1 week, and in the next week, we'll take up another problem on design of tall vessel. Okay.
So, sir, deadline is next week.
1 week.
Next week,
Thursday night.
Till 3. Okay, Thursday night. Okay, sir.
Thursday night, I think that is good enough.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, I think we can stop here in this particular class. Okay. And this lecture will also be circulated, but everything is there in the textbook also. Okay, so if you have any more queries, you can directly contact us, send mails, Devashish, Shourav, myself, any doubts, any point of time. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Sir, can you please explain again how to find the root area of the bolt?
Oh, that is very simple. So see, root area is the, if you look into the bolt, and if you look into the section, cross section of the bolt, it looks something like this, right?
Yes.
The bolt is specified like this number, M10 into 2, let's say. 10 means it's a stem diameter. This is 10. And what is 2? 2 is the depth. This is the depth. So root area is basically this area. So if this diameter is D1, root diameter, so let's say dr, so pi dr square is the root area. So the root area is nothing but pi stem diameter minus twice of depth. So this is depth. These two from this side and these two from that side, twice of depth, pi discovered by 4, sorry, square of that divided by 4. So this is the root area. So from these two numbers, you can calculate the root area of a particular bolt. Okay?
Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, Devashish and Shourav, is fine?
Yes, sir. It's okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, can you please tell what are the topics for like next class?
Next class, the topic is design of the tall vessel.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Oh. Thank you, sir.
Book. Yes, yes, please, tell me.
It is from which chapter from Bhattacharya book, your next topic?
It is chapter 7. This flange calculation is chapter 7.
No, sir, next topic.
Next topic, I think it is chapter 8, design of the tall vessel.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
You can get it in the content, okay? The design of tall vessel, the name of the chapter is same. Okay?
Yeah, they'll get it.
Okay. Yeah, I think it is chapter 9. Okay, you just check.
Okay, maybe chapter 9. No problem. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And we will be posting, as I have said, the deadline will be 1 week, and the detailed guidelines, the email ID where you need to send the assignment, we would be posting it soon, within 10-15 minutes on Teams, okay? So that you can know how to send the assignments, which email ID to send to.
Okay, so we can you know, close down this session now.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Showed up.
Bolo.
Anything more to discuss or anything else?
I think Saras told almost all the things. Like regarding submission of assignment, I would just request all of you to be careful while sending the assignments to the correct email ID, as Saras also mentioned.